welcome you to our 9 o'clock service. It's a little chilly outside this morning, but sun was shining. It was beautiful. We would like to ask you to please stand and join with us in our praise song, Surrender to Worship, and Open the Eyes of My Heart.
Thank you. Pastor Brad, while you're getting ready, I would like to take this time. I was going to say two miracles, but I think there's three miracles here today. First of all, my new grandson is here, Brooks Lee.
Amen.
He'll be 2 weeks on Tuesday, and all is doing well, so thank you for prayers on that. Second miracle is our daughter, Sarah Mae. No back brace today. We are praising God.
Amen.
For His mercy.
Yes.
Thank you so much for all your prayers. And the third miracle, which some of you may not realize is really a miracle, my mom and dad are here at the 9 o'clock service. Praise the Lord.
Again, it's always a pleasure to join together with our church family members and to welcome new ones and to see some of our most faithful members with us. I want to clarify that. They usually come to 10:30. They are very faithful. So we're just happy to have all of them and you with us this Sunday morning. Again, I want to invite you to greet one another. Before you do that, I'm changing it up a little bit again, asking the kids to hang in there till after the lighting of the candles in honor of deceased veterans. Someone asked me, is it the card just for veterans or for those who are no longer here? Therefore, those who are no longer here. We'd ask that if the kids can hang in here and not go to Sunday school till after that, we greatly appreciate it. So now that this time you may greet one another and say, I'm glad to see you.
We're here.
Hello, Tom Hayes. Good morning to you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Hi, Tom.
Say, folks at home.
I'm just happy I didn't put Ted down as a deceased veteran.
Okay. Hey, he looks reasonably alive this morning.
Okay. So I've been informed that I made a mistake. I know I never make those. But if you can add kindly serving as well on the card. So just write your names on it when you come up after the video presentation, and we will make sure to save the name that you tell us on the card. And so at this time, Steve has the video.
Thank you.
cards, and you probably got a little line going down the aisle, and we'll ask you to light a candle in honor of each of the people that you name. Hopefully we have enough candles. At this time, and you hand the card to me and I will read it.
You can get around.
Jim Aspel, Eric Lovinggood, Jim Wilson, and James Christian Lovinggood. John Canuck, George Canuck, and Marvin Stevens. Bill Farger. George Ennis. Ted Brothers. Gary Fincham. Earl Ward. Matt Shortness. Fred Rushing, James Glenn, and Reuben Rushing. Ron Richards, Don McCarrot, Derwin Williams, Robert L. Ekstrand, Lawrence Crapel, Tom Ledley, and Vince Ledley. Cecil Gutshell, Don Hurst, Cecil Roar, Bill Callison, Raymond Blundy, Carl Valenatos, Dewey Clark, Ashley Perriman, Raleigh flag. Robert Schultz. Brett Powers, Don Taylor, Dean Foreman. Robert Medina, James Powell, James Craig. Jack L. Wilson, Ellery King, Dale Wilson, Bernard German, Ed Lishman, Paul Hayes, Jeremy Roberts, Jean and Miriam Stewart, Jean Smith, Dylan Lane, James Scott, let us bow for a moment of prayer. Gracious God, again, we thank you for the service of those who have given of themselves. Some have passed beyond this veil of earthly existence. Others continue to walk amongst us. Make us truly thankful for their sacrifice. Make us appreciative of how you use them to make this a better place for us. We pray that you would give us a prayerful and thankful heart as we go forth from this day because of what others have done in your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now the kids may go to Sunday school as Larry and Heidi come on up here. Heidi didn't know she got to come with him. Yeah. See, I didn't tell her that. I said, Larry. She's not coming. No, come on. Again, in case you didn't know it, Larry is kind of retiring somewhat. We're still going to ask him to help us out at different special occasions as our church custodian. And Heidi is just like the power behind moving him forward to moving in new possibilities for life. So I wanted to call them both up. But Larry, I wanted to say to you just how much our congregation and that I personally have appreciated what you've given to us. Larry's been doing this for almost, what, 20 years? 15. To me, that's close enough to 20. 15 years and as our church custodian, and he's been very faithful, and he's just going to do some other things even as he continues to enjoy his life. There's a little token of our appreciation. There's a congregation in there. Don't lay it down. Okay. And a certificate here that just states how much we appreciate you. And hopefully you can put it someplace and just think about us in a positive way. But I'd like us to show our appreciation. Don't like to be up front. That, I thought I'd get one chance to do that.
Thank you.
Let us bow our heads and lift our hearts as we continue to move in an attitude of prayer and thanksgiving. God, some days it's a little easier than others to move. Some days our joints just don't seem to want to kick in motion, but you give us energy and you give us a will anyway. Lord, today make us truly thankful for what you have given us. Thankful for the freedoms we have and that we celebrate because of others' sacrifice. Thankful for the opportunity to worship in this place freely and joyfully. Lord, we ask that your spirit would move amongst us and through us and that you would inspire us to be a part of your service corps. That you would move in our hearts to see where we can reach out to others and share your love and your hope. Not just through words, but through actions and through examples of forgiveness and where we continue to touch those who are in hospitals and nursing homes and those who are homebound and those who are lonely and those who are grieving and those who are joyful and excited and exuberant. Lord, we pray that you would make us like the little girls I heard behind me this morning, singing your praises so joyfully with tender voices, that you give us a fresh outlook on how you move amongst us. This morning, Lord, we pray that you help us to see a world around us in a community that needs to know you. I didn't say be better off if they knew you. I said needs to know you. Lord, I pray that you would help us to be instruments of your son's hope and of your son's joy. And now, Lord, help us to pray together the prayer which the disciples taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, we would have our morning scripture.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Beautiful, sunshiny day. Scripture reading from this morning comes from Mark chapter 1, verses 29 through 39 from the New International Version. Jesus heals many. As soon as they left the synagogue, they went with James and John to the home of Simon and Andrew. Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they immediately told Jesus about her. So he went to her, took her hand, and helped her up. The fever left her, and she began to wait on them. That evening, after sunset, the people brought to Jesus all the sick and demon-possessed. The whole town gathered at the door, and Jesus healed many who had various diseases. He also drove out many demons, but he would not let the demons speak because they knew who he was. Jesus prays in a solitary place. Very, very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. Simon and his companions went to look for him, and when they found him, they exclaimed, "Everyone is looking for you." Jesus replied, "Let us go somewhere else, to the nearby villages, so I can preach there also. That is why I have come." So they traveled throughout Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and driving out demons. May the Lord bless the hearing of this word.
Amen. And as Doreen walks back to her seat, she is stepped up to the plate to not fill the shoes that Larry left, because they can't be filled, but she's doing her best to be our new church custodian. So we're always happy to have another person step up in leadership and service in our congregation. As I thought about this theme that we are still in called Be Still, some of you know I had a little trouble with that myself this week. It seemed like I was just being overwhelmed, and it just kind of took me for a moment to get back on track. I want to thank some people like Terry for reminding me of that. When I think about how easy it is to get off track in our relationship with Jesus, how easy it is to feel overwhelmed and to be moved in a direction that is not moving toward God. I'm reminded that the passages that Doreen has just shared with us from Mark are significant because they engage us. They invite us to be as Jesus was. Some people say to me, "Brad, what's this all got to do with real life? That church stuff, that Bible stuff? What does it really matter?" But when I think about knowing Jesus and being able to say no to things that pull us away from Jesus, I'm reminded that Jesus himself was a busy guy. I'm reminded that Jesus was preaching and teaching and healing all over the place, that some good stuff was going on, but sometimes he got so overwhelmed with that good stuff that he began to lose sight of what he was doing and why he was doing it. That he too had to pull away for just a moment to those deserted places to find peace and calm, to be redirected and refocused. Again, I'm reminded of times in my life where I too have had those times of being overwhelmed. Some would say, "Well, you mean in a bad way, right? You just got rid of all that bad stuff in your life." And yeah, there have been some bad times, but I'm thinking of more so the times in which there was so much good going on that I couldn't even catch myself. I thought about sending one of my little customary emails out to our United Methodist leadership, the district superintendents and bishop, and every so often I like to remind them of what God is doing amongst us here through this congregation in Elmwood. And I started to say, I would start that email out with, "You know, all of that stuff we sign up for when we accept God's call to ministry, you know, visiting babies being born in a hospital and visiting people who are having knee replacements and surgeries on their leg and being with families at time of bereavement and transition and being with young people who are exploring their faith and challenging and pushing the boundaries so that they can figure out where their place is in this world. And being with people who are seeking to share in missional ways God's love, whether it is through the Christmas shoeboxes or through Pleasant Hill Ministry with gloves and hats for poor children, or whether it's some other facet of ministry that seeks to be with the least, the lost, and the last, like through the Ministers Alliance, where we've collected food and where we're collecting food to give to those in need and preparing to share a little bit of joy through Christmas gifts and Christmas baskets, and looking at the future Sunday school needs and opportunities, and even visioning into next summer with vacation Bible school preparations. Yes, preparing for vacation Bible school in November. But when I think about all of that, and then every once in a while, some of y'all like to drop by my office and say, "Pastor Brad, have you heard? obviously and normally I haven't heard. So I have to stop all that preparation and just listen. And then at the end of the day, I'm like, man, where do I even start? But when I think about all of those opportunities, sometimes I get overwhelmed. Sometimes I really don't know where to start. Sometimes I have to say, what is the priority for today? And how am I going to be about God's business that God has called me into in this community, through this congregation, at this time in the history of this world and in this community? And it gets a little fuzzy because there's so much good that I could be doing and that we are about doing that it just maybe overwhelms me. And I believe that Jesus might have been like that on occasion or two. Verse 35 really nails this down and seeks to guide us when it says, early in the morning, well before sunrise, Jesus rose and went to a deserted place where he could be alone in prayer. Now, there are times in which we all need to be alone in prayer. That's part of our be still theme, is carving out that time, making time, expanding on that time. And I thought I was doing good with that time until Thursday, and it just seemed like I couldn't make that time. People kept calling, people kept knocking, emails kept popping up, my little phone just never stopped vibrating and making all kind of interesting sounds. And they were all real. It wasn't like they were just saying, shooting the breeze, hi Brad. People had real needs. People had real questions. But yet, we and I, and you especially, need that time alone. Where do we go to be alone in prayer? Well, I like to go to the Elmwood Township Community Center to, the place with those little workout machines, and where if you go early in the morning, there's hardly anyone there. Just one friend in the back. He'll come in and pick up the key for the weight room and say, hi, Pastor, as I'm dripping sweat all over that elliptical machine. Again, I want to thank you who donated to make that possible, because the church has paid my family's membership to be a part of that facility through the pastor's appreciation gift. So again, thank you for that. You allow me a place to sweat and pray at the same time. When I think about how important that time alone is, and when I don't make that time, not only does my body feel bad, but my spirit is overwhelmed. Again, there are times in life that we set aside that rejuvenate us and re-energize us and help us to refocus. And another time for myself and for my wife, Debbie, refocusing is in the mornings in the summertime. We like to walk down the road in front of our house to the end of the fields and kind of come back, and we're talking and conversing, and usually Debbie is telling me how to get my life right. And I'm sharing how I don't think that might be it, but we have a good time, and it refocuses us early in the morning. One of our neighbors shared with me in the community, I can't remember where I was, that he and his wife live in two of the houses that we walk past on that walk, and how every morning they'd have their window open hoping they could hear a little bit of our conversation. and it was funny what they would hear sometimes. And yet, in those moments of seeking God's direction, in those moments of seeking to connect with God as we connect with other human beings, it is important. It is, I would say, catastrophically and dynamically important that we remember why we are here. What is our mission? What is our purpose? Each and every one of us has a mission and purpose. Each and every one of us is important. I've had some people say to me, Brad, I can't physically do what I used to do, so I'm worthless. I don't have a purpose. I've had people say to me, Pastor, I'm just so busy. I'm working 60, 70 hours a week, and I don't seem to be getting anywhere with all of that work. I'm struggling to see a purpose in it other than paying the bills, and paying the bills is a good purpose. But most of us need something more than that. Most of us need something that has some eternal value, some intrinsic connection to others outside of us. And so as we seek to define and connect with that mission, I'd like to invite you to join with me as we kind of read the vision and mission of this congregation. Now, it was here before I got here, but I thought it still was very, very relevant. Now, remember, this is not a brag thing. We're going to read this together. I tried that before and you just looked at it. Okay, here we go. We are followers of Jesus, connecting to God and one another, growing in faith and pouring our lives into serving others. How basic is that? Serving others. Pouring our lives into others. Connecting to Jesus. Again, somebody once said to me, or actually several people in the last 6 months have called me up or emailed me or private messaged me, or some have dropped through our doors and they kind of give me a little theological test. They want to see if I'm a real Christian or not. And then they'll whip out a Bible or two and they'll ask me different questions about what does your church really believe, Brad? And you know, we're not sure about those United Methodists and we're not sure about institutional religion altogether, but we kind of like what we're hearing out on the street. And it's good when people tell you they like what they're hearing about your church and they want to come in and quiz you. And I say to them, well, I'm going to be honest with you. Our congregation is a little diverse from a biblical theological perspective, but come in and try us out. Just see what we're all about. You know, kick the tires. Look under the hood a little bit. Connect with some people. Bring your kids to Sunday school. Come to worship and see if we are what you think God is calling you to be. It'd be easy to spout off a whole bunch of theological phrases and pull up a whole bunch of biblical passages and say, that's it. That's what we are. And that's all you need to know. But I believe, and I believe Jesus believed this as well, that relationships are key to that type of understanding becoming real. How do we make those words we just read, the words that, by the way, in case you lose your bulletin cover, are on the front of the library, right above the doors of our church library. How do we make those words mean something? Connecting with Jesus, connecting with others, they mean something. That's what it's all about. But you know, it's a little bit tricky sometimes. So let's maybe hear what someone else had to say about this Jesus relationship thing.
Hello.
Sarah, hey. Stop it, Jesus.
Jesus! Hey! How are you?
Okay, you know, just holding all of the cosmos together. Same old, same old.
Right. Quite a big job you have there.
Yeah, well, you know. So, how are things with you? Good?
Yeah, things are good. Just busy. Been really busy.
Yeah. Stressed a little bit?
Yeah, I've just had this thing with work that's been so difficult, and...
Yeah, that thing with Jen.
Right. How'd you know?
Sarah, I'm God, you know, people love me this thing, I know everything.
Right. Well, then you must know that I've had this presentation coming up next week, which I'm totally unprepared for. I've been like freaking out about it all week, and actually, come to think of it, if there's any way you could step in and make me sound good, that'd be awesome.
Yeah. How about this? I promise I'll be right there with you the whole time. I won't leave your side.
Right, yes. That'd be great, Jesus. I want you there, no questions. It's just, I'd feel a little better if I knew you were gonna make it go over well, you know? And I did give some money to that homeless guy yesterday. Right, Jimmy. I did give some money to Jimmy.
Right. I'm glad that you did that, but I gotta tell you, if you're thinking that that's gonna buy you some sort of spiritual favors or something, that's really not how this works. You know, I want to be in relationship with you. I want to be close to you. I want to have intimacy with you.
I know. I'm sorry. It's just, I can't see you. And to be honest, it's not that easy to be in a relationship with someone invisible, you know?
Yes, I know. But I think the more you try it, the more you spend time with me and talk to me and listen, the easier it gets.
Yeah, I know. It's just with work and everything. It's a lot.
I know your work is important, and I'm really glad you're doing what you're doing. But just know that nothing in this life is going to give you as much peace and joy and fulfillment as I am.
I hear you.
I love you, Sarah, and I'm proud of you, and I want what's best for you.
Thanks, Jesus.
So, what do you think? Can we talk more often?
Yeah, that sounds nice.
Cool. Love you, Sarah.
Love you, too.
Bye.
So, when we know Jesus in the deep recesses of our hearts, then we are better able to say no. Now, again, some of you saw a little sign out front. Thank Gary Farber again for doing that for us. But he said, Brad, what do you want on the sign this week? And I said, well, the sermon title is Knowing Jesus and Knowing and Knowing Jesus. And my wife said, is that a misprint, a misspelling? Aren't you missing something in that sign? And I said, no, that's the thing. Because sometimes people like me, I don't know about you, but people like me have to say no to things or even people that are good when they pull us off purpose. Someone said, well, isn't your job to serve all people all the time? And I'm like, no, that's not my job. My job is to lead people to Jesus, to help us connect with one another, and then to connect with God's world. Now, that might seem a little bit harsh sometimes, and believe me, if you haven't figured this out by now, I'm a people person. I'd rather be hanging out with you all the time. I hate sitting in my desk. I hate sending out emails. I detest having to come up with programs and plans and writing. I like the vision. I like to dream about things. I like to go out and be with people who are having babies or people who are struggling with something major in their life, like a job decision or possibly being laid off from a job or struggling with pain or loss. That's where I'm really gifted at, but yet that's only part of my job. And so I have to figure out what to say no to and who to say no to say, well, I'd love to talk with you for about 3 or 4 hours today, but right now, I think I need to help you find some other source of help. Or right now, we need to make an appointment for next week so that we can make sure that I have completed the purposes and the focus that God has given me right now. And it's so easy to be pulled off task. It's so easy to answer that call or to spend a huge amount of time with one situation or one purpose to the point that we don't even answer the phone in the video, like the lady in the video, when Jesus is really calling us because we're so focused on trying to do everything. Now, someone said to me, Brad, you've given me an excuse to tell you no when you ask me to do something in the church. No, I haven't. What I've asked you to do, though, is to focus. You don't have to say yes to everything, but God is calling you to say yes to something. How many of us in here have not said yes to something that we can directly connect to our faith in God through Jesus Christ? What is that thing that you have said yes to in the last year, 6 months, month, week, that connects you with connecting others with Jesus Christ? Each and every one of us has a purpose and a mission in this world that calls us to say yes to that and no to other things. It's in the knowing, the N-O hyphen I-N-G, that we are able to better know Jesus and the fullness of his beauty and the joy and the hope that God offers us. Relationships is what Jesus is all about. Relationships is what God wants us to have with one another and with God. But relationships require time and focus investment. Now notice I used a financial word, not a psychological counseling word. Investment. Many of us can understand what an investment is. We have to put something in to get something out. We put stuff in and we look at it being nurtured and growing and maturing and hopefully giving us a greater yield than what we've actually invested. That's what most of us believe relationships, or at least hope relationships, should be. I know that's what it is with my relationship with God. I get a lot more out of it than I have actually put into it. But yet, I have to invest something. It doesn't just magically appear. I have to invest some prayer time. I have to invest some financial resources that I could use for other things. I have to invest my own personal time, which is more valuable than any dollar sign could be placed on it, in relationships. Somebody once said to me, "Brad, you and Debbie sure like to go out of town a lot. You see your posts from all over the state or other places." And I say to you, that's part of my and our investment in one another. Because believe it or not, as long as I'm within a 20-mile radius of this spot here, I'm thinking about you all the time. I'm not thinking about my kids. I'm not thinking about what I should be doing as a husband and all. But I try to weave all of that in. But I'm the kind of guy, I just get overwhelmed and I allow myself to become so focused on this great ministry that I don't invest in those relationships. So I have to leave town to actually invest in them some more. And then remind me about how good it is back here when I talk to some of my friends around the country and around the conference, and they don't talk about kids coming to Sunday school. They don't talk about young people preparing those shoe boxes that you're going to be invited to put things in for the Operation Christmas Child program. They don't talk about the praise and worship groups, whether it's Closer to Free or New Day or all the little microphone chorus that we're going to have strung out across this stage when the kids' praise team sings next week. They don't talk about how they're going to balance out a new ministry with youth, like we're trying to invest in with the Youth Life program this afternoon. Or they don't talk about, now, how do I work in this confirmation with all these great kids, youth group, visit people, and work on my sermons and prepare for worship leadership. They just talk about what they don't have and who they don't see, and what they do have that's negative around them. So I know that I am blessed to be here. But yet still, relationships is what God wants us to invest in. And so I have to make time to be focused on that investment. I pray that you too are making time for that. How should we ask God to help us? As followers of Jesus Christ, how should we ask God to help us focus the time, energy, and resources God has given us? Now, it has been said that we need to learn our purpose. Other people have said it, not me. I got it from them. Our purpose and mission as individuals first, and then as a congregation next, to know what God has called us to be and what God has called us to say. and what God has called us to do in this world. I want to invite our worship leaders back up as we continue to worship in this spirit. But as I think about knowing Jesus and knowing Jesus, they remind me that you have been very generous, not just with your resources, but with your time. But I'm asking you to be more focused with that time. You might have to tell me no so that you can really focus on being a Sunday school teacher. You might have to say no to something so that you can focus on making it to praise band practice, because I heard some great voices out there and all of you need to be singing or playing in some group. The choir, maybe the second service. Whatever you feel God is calling you to know and to be able to focus on. This morning, again, there's an opportunity to serve in some way. Look at all those little clipboards out there. Denise doesn't just prepare them for her own health. She would like you to actually stop and sign some of them, because God is calling you in some specific ministry. Some great little decorated boxes out there. Take one and fill it up so that we can dedicate it next week to go somewhere around the world in the name of Jesus the Christ. Again, how is God calling you to be quiet and then serve? At this time, will the ushers come forward?
Jesus, be the same.
Because I believe that as we seek to be still and know God, that He calls us to touch one another, that the world might know that God is touching them. And so I send you forth with praise and thanksgiving. I send you forth with hope and hopefully a little bit more re-energized and focused. I send you forth to go get some good snacks that the senior high school has prepared for us at the Coffee Fellowship. But go forth knowing that you are not alone and that God walks with you. Amen.
Amen.